and welcome back to Travels with Ketan. If you are just joining us, introduce myself. I'm a biker, backpacker and travel writer. And in this video, we will be reading another part from my book, Three Men Ride Again, The Amigos Ride to Spiti. This is a story of, well, obviously, three amigos riding to Spiti. So the first part was the overture, where I mentioned that Delzad and I had gone for a ride to Rajasthan. And Delzad had had an accident, and he had just had a mix-up with a deer, crashed his bike, gone flying, and landed. And I was wondering what to do next. So here we are. So remember, we have just landed, and here it goes. Three men ride again, overture, the accident. So here we were again, in the middle of a desert with nobody and nothing in sight. Just a dark desert highway, as the eagles might say. The bike was mangled and the rider was down in the dust. There were two villagers walking along the road, and they seemed to be the most phlegmatic of men. They saw the accident happen, but did not change their speed or their gait by an iota. They just kept walking at the same pace. My adrenaline kicked in, and I, without stopping to think, I ran into the middle of the road and I waved desperately for passing cars to stop. This must have scared some cars deeply, seeing a fat giant guy dressed like the Terminator waving crazily for them to stop. They just zipped past, swerving enough to avoid me. The two villagers finally reached us. They regarded us unemotionally for some time. And then finally asked a most penetrating question. Had an accident? What a stupid question. I was tempted to reply, "No, I am doing a mujra and this guy is a prince watching from his couch." But I was too worked up for sarcasm and I just replied, "Yes." "Ah," one nodded disinterestedly. The other just spat tobacco juice into the sack. They said, and just kept walking. I watched in disbelief as they walked away without another word. No attempt to help or to get more info or gossip or nothing. Most un-Indian. Quite a few vehicles passed by without stopping, and then I waved all over the road like when kabaddi tackle. "Stop, stop, 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 stop," and forced the next guy to stop. The guy was a good guy. He agreed to take Baba to the nearest government hospital. This was at Falodi, about 70 kilometers away. I thanked him, "Thank you, thank you, thank you," and went to pick up Baba. And all he said was, "My goggles, my goggles." "What?" The bloody fellow's knee was broken and he was thinking about his sunglasses. We stopped and he bent over and picked them up. And with our help, he got into the car but groaned deeply as even the slightest movement was causing tremendous pain to his broken knee. Baap re. He was terribly brave. I would have been bawling like a baby by then. Shit, I thought. Went to my bike, pulled out my medical kit, gave him a strip of painkillers, told him to take 2, 3, 10 pills as much as you want. We put him into the car and they sped off, with me assuring them that I will be following them on the bike immediately. I dragged his bike to the side of the road and hid it behind some place so it should not get stolen, and then sped off after them. On the way, I got in touch with the local guy and told him about the accident and asked him to meet me at the hospital. It took me more than an hour to reach that place at Falodi. I had forgotten everything about that car. What was the model of the car, what number, what the driver looked like. It was all a blur. Luckily, I had taken his mobile number and called him as soon as I reached the hospital. He met me at the entrance and took me to the OPD where Delzad was lying wearily on a cot. There seemed to have been no treatment at all. Not even a cleanup of the wound or anything. "What's going on?" I said. "Where's the doctor?" "There's been a two-wheeler accident." "That's one," somebody replied. "I know there's been a two-wheeler accident. This is the victim lying right there." "No, no, no," that orderly replied. "What I mean is that the doctor has been in an accident. See, here he is." And he was in the cot next to Delzad, fully blood covered, moaning and groaning. "Huh? Isn't there another doctor here?" "Yes, sir, but he's treating the first doctor. See, and after he treats the first doctor, he'll come to you." So I went to Delzad and asked him how he was. "I'm okay. The ride was very bad, but they gave me a painkiller injection as soon as I came in here, so now I'm feeling better." So I asked the orderly, is there an ambulance here? Clearly, we would have been had to be taken to a hospital in the nearest city. Yes, sir, we have one. But it is booked. Booked for whom? For this doctor, sir, who is lying right next to you. At least take an x-ray and find out where the break is. We have no x-ray machine, sir. We have only first aid. Shit. I was getting pissed off. So finally that guy arrived, Montu, whom I had called, and I gave him, I told him to do two things. Go and get a truck, find Delzad's bike and bring it to Jodhpur. And where is the bike, sir, he asked. I don't know, just ride along the road and look for an accident site and you'll be fine, you'll see the bike there. It's about 70 kilometers down, start counting your odometer. And secondly, to get me a taxi to get help, Delzad to Jodhpur, since ambulance is not available. So I went back to Delzad. Look, finally the doctor was with him, pinching and prodding him to make sure, to check for internal injuries and stuff. He said, it's a fracture for sure, the doctor said. Luckily there doesn't seem to be any other injury. You better take him to a bone and joint hospital ASAP. Can't you treat him? I asked. And he almost laughed. This is a small government hospital. We have no x-ray machine. What will you do here? Take him to Jodhpur. There is a private bone and joint specialty hospital there since his knee is broken. All I can do is give you a painkiller injection. Shit. Okay. I asked for a taxi. We'll leave as soon as the taxi comes. Sir, I looked up. That fellow, one guy in a white uniform was beaming at me. I have an ambulance, sir. He gave me a 1000-watt smile. I thought you reserved it for that doctor fellow. No, sir. Doctor Saab has said that it is not required for injured doctor. It is available if you want. Of course I want. Load him immediately. I called Montu and told him, forget the cab, go and pick up the bike. In all this, the good person who had brought Delzad to the hospital decided to leave. I was so stressed and wound up that I didn't even realize when he had left, and I didn't even get to thank him. But I'd like to thank him now. Thank you. God bless you. And I hope he gets ample good karma for his really disinterested good deed. God bless you. The ambulance left for Jodhpur. And I followed it after last minute instructions to Montu. Jodhpur was about 140 kilometers from Falodi and it would take at least 2 to 3 hours to reach. So off we go again. Here I was zooming down the road to Jodhpur in hot pursuit of the ambulance that was carrying the damaged Delzad. And I suddenly screeched to halt in the bend of the road because the bull was right in the middle of the road, right in the middle of the road. And I had to wait for it to cross. I cursed that bull and his cow and the entire bovine family in general. And just as I passed him, I noticed there was a pretty huge speed breaker in the road. And it was covered by the shadow of one tree that was standing right next to it. So you couldn't see the speed breaker. If I had not seen that bull or that bull had not crossed that road, I would have gone bang into the speed breaker and there would be two people in that ambulance. Shiva, Shiva, I said, thanking Lord Shiva for sending his Nandi bull to save me from the accident and carried on. But much more carefully. If I also bought it, then things would get very hairy. As it is, it was getting late, it was getting dark. And I wanted to reach within striking distance of Jodhpur before it got fully dark. As your speed goes down dramatically in the dark, especially in India. Well, at least mine does. Because I am shit scared of overspeeding and I can't see the road. As it is, your enough issues right in daytime with potholes, speed breakers, suicidal animals, suicidal cyclists, pedestrians, murderous trucks, buses, you name it, there's anything on the road. I was gunning the bike and thanking God that my bike was in good shape and running well. Then suddenly I felt something go weird. The clutch felt suddenly spongy. Oh shit, my clutch cable had broken. Now I couldn't change the bike or change the gear or put the bike in neutral. And I didn't have a spare clutch cable on me. And as usual, the road was empty. No shops, no repair people, nobody, no civilization in sight. Shit. I kept going as long as I could. The problem with a broken clutch is obviously when you upshift, that is going to higher gear, you cannot downshift and go into a lower gear because you can't press the clutch. And when the bike will come to a halt once the speed is too low for that gear, and then you're screwed because you can't restart the bike unless it's in neutral, and you can't put it in neutral because there's no clutch. I was shitting bricks. I tried to ride as fast as possible to cover distance and find some civilization, but slow enough that I didn't have to upshift. But habit is a bad thing, and after some time I saw a nice smooth highway. I sped up and automatically I upshifted, moved to a higher gear by sheer habit, and shit. As I tried to slow down, the bike cuffed and hiccuped and came to a halt. No, 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 I said and tried to restart it, but the bike just sneered at me in true Royal Enfield fashion and came to a halt. I shouted and threw my hands up in despair. And I looked around and I couldn't believe my eyes. I had come to a stop by sheer chance right in front of a shop. It was the only shop around. It was like a clear blank road. There's nothing around on miles. But that one shop. And I had come to a halt just in front of that shop. And it was a bike repair shop. Can you beat that? The repair guy came out and inquired what I wanted. And I told him my clutch cable is snapped. And he said, no problem, sir. Give me your spare. I will fix it immediately. He said, yes, problem. I don't have a spare. I don't think I have one either. Let me check. And he went inside. But now I was, you know, oddly relaxed. I said, the fates are with me finally. Otherwise, why would I come to a stop in front of this shop in the middle of nowhere? And I knew it. He came out saying, I have one cable left, sir. One last cable. It is not actually for Enfield. It is one Chalu cable, but it will get you for till Jodhpur. I said, boss, you get me to Jodhpur. That's all I want. After a few minor mishaps, Google Maps kept sending me round and round and round and round in the dark. But I finally somehow managed to get to Jodhpur and I found that hospital. Thank you, Google Maps. Once we got out of that endless loop, it was thank you, Google Maps. I parked my bike and I went inside. The ambulance was not inside, so I assumed it had been paid off. It had hopefully delivered its cargo and then been paid off. I clumped into the hospital and scared the hotel staff considerably, since I was dressed in my riding boots and my eyes were red and I was looking like a wild man. I found Delzart sitting sadly on a stretcher with wheels, alone outside the OPD. They had taken his x-rays and put a plaster on him, and then just left him there. Why are you outside in the hallway? I asked irritatedly. I didn't ask him, I asked the hospital guy. Why you left him outside the hallway? Oh, sir, we didn't know whether you want to admit him or not. Of course, you admit him. Get in the best room you have, one with an assistant bed where I can stay as well. What nonsense? How can you leave a patient in the bloody corridor? I growled at them, and then they finally were installed in the room. Once Delzad was comfortable, I started calling various people to set up all the tasks. I called the most important person first, which is Bharti, my wife. She, you must be obeyed. I told her to book Jodhpur-Bombay tickets, pending okay from the doctor the next day. I called Montu, the local guy, and I was relieved to find that he had found the bike, miracle, and had loaded it in his truck. I called the local Gati courier office. Gati is a courier company, G-A-T-I. I had booked transport for the two bikes from Jodhpur to Mumbai. I found a number for a local ambulance and tentatively booked an ambulance to take Baba to the airport. I called Baba's dad, poor guy. He had been so worried, and I gave him the news update. I called Adi, our third amigo, and told him about it. So Baba had called him, so he knew what was the problem. And then finally, luckily, my phone died. So I had no choice but to put it on charge and I went to sleep. I was so strung up from the events of the day. What stress. The next morning was also a lot of running around. I caught hold of that courier guy, explained the situation to him. But he was very friendly, very helpful. He came to the hospital, I handed him the papers, filled out forms, paid him money. Then he said, sir, I'm only a single person. So you come with me to the office and then I'll drop you back. So whatever. So I followed him on my bike to the depot, gave him the keys, came back to the hospital by auto rickshaw. I told him that Montu will deliver the damaged bike directly to his depot and I left the money to be paid to Montu with him. At the hospital, the head doctor came over and he explained that his knee joint was broken. And there was an operation pin, all that kind of stuff. It was a obviously a very major job, and his dad obviously said ki if it's not life threatening or urgent, send him back to Bombay immediately. They had already plastered up his leg, so we took a certificate, medical certificate, saying that he was okay to be transported. The airline would not allow him on the plane without that certificate. We paid up the hospital bill, took the discharge, and the ambulance was ready, and we were all set to leave for the flight. At the airport, Jet Airways says, no, we can't accept this. Why? What the problem? So the doctor certificate said he's okay to travel, but not okay to travel by air. So I cripped and waved my hands about what nonsense, what idiocy, what stupidity. Call the doctor. And stupid doctor, why does he? Anyway, never mind. So the whole thing happened and they finally allowed him to board. So this is a pro tip. If you ever have an accident and you want to transfer that there by air, ensure that these words are there in doctor's certificate, ki that is fit to travel by air. In Jodhpur, Jet Airways didn't have that thingy to transport directly to the plane. They didn't have a lift, so they only had one of those, you know, rolling ladders. So they actually got a wheelchair with bars on it. And four guys should lift it up the stairs. So Delzad looked like a Maharaja in a palanquin. A very nervous Maharaja. Who half expected one of these guys should slip and fall and make a Humpty Dumpty out of him. But they managed to get him up without dropping him. And we had another small issue when the jet staff wouldn't give him an aisle seat. Yeah, in spite of his leg being in a giant cast. No, you have been assaulted, middle seat, so you sit there. Luckily, the guy in the aisle seat volunteered to move himself, and so Del could sit comfortably. But all's well that ends well. Finally, we landed in Mumbai, put him in a wheelchair, wheeled him out to meet his anxious family, and immediately they whisked him off to the hospital for his operation. It would be some time before the Amigos would ride again. Well, that's all for this segment, guys. Stay tuned for the next chapter in Three Men Ride Again. And obviously, subscribe, press that button, and go to my website, ketanjoshi.net, where you can see all my books, all my blogs, my podcasts, and the photo galleries. Cheers. See you for the next chapter. Mm-hmm.